Welcome to Re'e Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures. That we've had so far today on the subject that you've led me to share about, especially about anointing. And we thank you, Father, that we are going to look into another aspect of anointing this morning. And we pray for you to open our hearts and minds and our ears and our eyes to be able to receive from you and to be doers of your word. In Yeshua's name, amen. Amen. So I've got a little humorous story here for the women, because after all, the women are having such a good time here, right? One day, a man spotted a lamp by the roadside. He picked it up, rubbed it vigorously, and a genie appeared. I'll grant you your fondest wish, the genie said. The man thought for a moment, then said, I want a spectacular job, a job that no man has ever succeeded at or has ever attempted to do. Poof, said the genie, you're a housewife. Well, last week was a great time, even if you didn't go on the women's retreat, with Ted Pierce here. And just really thankful for him and the things that he shared. We're going to be moving out on some of those things. 2 weeks ago, if you can remember that far back, how many can remember 2 weeks ago? Yeah, okay. Pastor Reuben was here, and he taught about the anointing for healing. Remember that? And pointed out that there was a step in there that oftentimes is missed, which was confession. And then there was anointing, and also about, it wasn't just like dabbing oil on, but rubbing oil on people. So I was impacted by that, and I was just praying about what to share about this week. And the Holy Spirit began to talk to me about how there are some other things for which anointing is done. And they are very important things. So I did what all good Bible students do. When you want to know about a particular word, you go to the first occurrence in the Bible, when it first appears. So the first occurrence of anoint is in a verse in Exodus where it's speaking about the priestly garments. God is speaking about the priestly garments to Moses. And in chapter 28, in verse 41, God says this to Moses, put them, that's the priestly garments, on Aaron your brother and on his sons with them, and anoint them, consecrate them, and sanctify them so that they may minister to me as Kohanim, or priests. And what was interesting about this to me was sometimes you see like synonyms used in biblical text and you just think, oh, they just mean the same thing. But I've found that whenever you see things, you know, like this and this and this, and they're all sort of similar, you go back to the Hebrew and you find out that they really each one have a very specific meaning. It's not just that they were just throwing out words there. It was a very specific meaning. So in this one little verse, I saw six different things that about the priests, about the Kohanim, that were done to prepare them to step into their priestly role. And I put them in a little table here. First of all, to be part of the Kohanim, they had to be born into the line of Aaron. They had to be descendants of Aaron, his sons and his grandsons, and so on. Secondly, this speaks about garments, holy garments. And so they had to put on, and the Hebrew word there is where it says, put on, put them on Aaron. It's lavashta. Put on the priestly garments. And then before you can put on the garments, it's a little bit funny because you go to a later chapter to find out what had to be done before they put on the garments. What do you think had to be done before they could put on the garments? Anybody guess? They had to wash, right? So before they, in chapter, if you want to take notes and look these up, because we are going to just refer to a lot of verses here for time's sake, Chapter 29, verse 4 speaks about washing in water before putting on the garments. And then we come to these other three words. And the first word is consecrate them. And consecrate actually is in the Hebrew, meleta et yada, which means lay your hands on them. Now, I don't know how they got consecrate out of there, except that consecrate means to set apart. Set them apart by laying your hands on them. Or we would say ordain them. Lay your hands on them to ordain them. And then the second word in there, which is anoint. Well, I got sanctified before. Sanctify them. That word is very different in Hebrew, kidashta. And that is to set them apart for holiness, set them apart for God's purposes. And the third word there is anoint, and that's mashachta. And that's to put oil on them. And the root of that word is mashach. So let's all say that. It's got a ch sound on the end, mashach. And try to remember that, because that's going to be very important later, because we're going to be talking about anointing. And Carolyn, it was amazing that she chose that song about the anointing coming down. So also in these passages, there's instructions for making the oil for the anointing. If you want to look it up, it's in Exodus chapter 30, verses 22 through 33, what the ingredients are. And this oil for the anointing wasn't just used for this purpose, but the altar, the menorah, the tabernacle, the furnishings, the laver of washing, all of those were to be anointed with this oil. And there's also, interestingly, a prohibition against using this anointing oil in any other way other than what God had commanded. But if you are familiar with the Tanakh, and if you've read through it, you will realize that anointing was done to other people too. The prophets were anointed with oil, and the kings were anointed by the prophets. So, why should this be important to us today, this anointing of the Kohanim? Well, in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9, we have this foundational verse. We've come back to this many times. But you are a chosen people, the king's Kohanim. And in Hebrew, that's mamlachat Kohanim, a kingdom of priests, a holy nation, a people for God to possess. So the first thing to understand about this verse is, who is Peter talking about? Well, again, I'm not going to go there, but if you look at the beginning of the book of Peter, chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, it's to Jewish and Gentile followers of Yeshua. So what he's saying is here, we Messianic Jews and Messianic Gentiles, we are mamlachat Kohanim. We are the king's Kohanim, the king's priests. So what king? What king are we talking about here? King Messiah. We are a royal priesthood. Everybody got that? Just kind of point to yourself, I am a royal Kohen. Kohen is singular or priest. So because as followers of Yeshua, you and I were all called to be Kohanim, it's important to understand some things. What are the requirements to be a Kohen? What are the duties? What are the roles we're supposed to fill? And what are the privileges? What are the rewards of being Kohanim? Now, I'm using the word Kohanim, and I hope you can all get used to it, because I don't want to use the word priest all the time, because coming from a Jewish background, priest is a very un-Jewish word. Okay, when I hear the word priest, I think of a Catholic church leader. All right, so it's interesting that priests or Kohanim really are a very Jewish word, because that was way before the Catholic Church, thousands of years, there was the Aaronic priesthood or the Kohanim. So in the past, some of you may remember, I've given like a broad definition of a Kohen, what they do. And I talked about them speaking to God for the people and speaking to the people from God. Anybody remember? That's kind of the short summary. So today, I'm going to go into greater detail on how these things apply to you as a Kohen. So first, we're going to talk about requirements. God gave Moses special requirements for the Aaronic Kohanim. And everybody should understand, Kohanim is plural, Kohen is singular. Okay, everybody got that? Okay. And the requirements for purity were more stringent than for the rest of the Israelites. So I'm just going to give out some biblical verses here because I don't want to take time to go through them, but a lot of them are in Leviticus 21. Verses 1 through 4 talk about ceremonial cleanliness, touching a dead body. You couldn't touch a dead body except for the death of a close relative if you were a Kohen. There are rules for even for grooming, what you can cut of your hair. There's restrictions on who your marriage partners can be in verse 7. In verse 9, there's rules for the behavior of your children. In 17 through 24, there's rules disqualifying people who were somehow disfigured in their body. And then in chapter 22, there's rules for handling the consecrated things. And in the same chapter, verses 4 through 16, there's rules for how to eat the offerings, because the Kohanim ate the offerings. And then in Exodus chapter 30, verses 19 to 20, there's rules for washing. All of these things are for the Kohanim. And the question is why? Why are these extra requirements for purity for the Kohanim? Well, in that same chapter, Leviticus 21, verse 6, it says this, they, the Kohanim, are to be holy to their God, not profane the name of their God, for they present the offerings of Adonai made by fire, the bread of their God, therefore they are to be holy. And that word holy is the word kadosh, separate, set apart for God. And understand, we've talked about this lots of times in the past, God is holy, and the Kohanim came into his presence in a special way. You know, we're all in God's presence all the time. I mean, he is everywhere. But there are times when the level of approach requires a greater level of holiness to come into God's presence. So God gave all these rules for the Kohanim to be set apart, to be holy. But also, in Leviticus chapter 4, verse 3, we read very interesting thing about God and what he understands. It says this in verse 3, or if the anointed Kohen sins so as to bring guilt on the people, then let him offer for his sin which he has committed a young bull without blemish to Adonai for a sin offering. So we see here the amazing thing about our Lord. What does he understand about human nature? Even Kohanim will sin. And so he provided atonement, forgiveness for when the Kohanim sinned. So those are the kind of the prerequisites for being a Kohen. Now, what are the roles of the Kohanim? What duties did they have? And what do those things mean to us in terms of as we look at them? So they were to present offerings to the Lord. We just read about that in the verse in Leviticus 21, verse 6. Now, understand, this is a little bit hard for us to understand because we think of worship as singing songs and lifting up our voices and dancing. But in the Tanakh, the main form of worship was offering sacrifices. That was the main form of worship. So the Kohanim were worship leaders. They led people in worship. And then in Exodus chapter 28, verse 12, we read, fasten two stones upon the shoulder pieces of the ephod to be memorial stones for Bnei Israel, the sons of Israel. So Aaron is to bear their names before Adonai on his two shoulders as a reminder. So Aaron is, just so you get this terminology right, he's the Kohen HaGadol. Gadol means high. So he's the high priest. And he bore the names of the tribes of Israel on their shoulders. What's that all about? That's a form of intercession. He was bringing the names of the people, the tribes of the people, before God when he would go into the sanctuary. And then in chapter 30 of Exodus, verse 7, it instructs the Kohanim to burn incense. And we understand that incense is the prayers of the people. So the Kohen was to lead the people in prayer and was to pray for the people. So there's this role of intercessor. Kohen is an intercessor. And then in Exodus 28 and verse 30, it says, also put the Urim and the Thummim within the breastplate of judgment so they will be on Aaron's heart when he goes in before Adonai. Aaron will bear the judgment of Bnei Israel on his heart before Adonai continually. So this is another form of intercession, but also there's the task of getting direction from God. That's what the Urim and the Thummim did. We don't know how they did that. There's lots of theories, but nobody knows for sure. But when they wanted direction from God, they would somehow use these things that were kept on the heart of the high priest. And the getting direction for God was both for judging, when we had to judge whether a person needed to be punished or whether they were guilty or not, or whether something was good to use or not, or also for action. Should we go here or should we do this? They went before the Lord with this. So that's another role of the Kohen. Do you see that? Getting direction, walking in the Spirit, helping himself, but also the people to be led by the Spirit. And then, again, speaking of the Kohen HaGadol in Leviticus 16, verse 24, it says this: he is to bathe himself with water in a holy place, put on his garments, and come out to offer his burnt offering and the offering of the people to make atonement for himself and for the people. So what's the duty of the Kohen there? Making atonement. And then in 2 Chronicles 17, verses 8 through 9, we read that the Kohanim were to teach the word to the people. They were sent out all through the cities of Israel to teach the word. So the Kohanim were teachers and preachers. And in Numbers chapter 6, verses 23 to 27, this is one that you are all familiar with. The Lord what you? Bless you. They were to bless the people. And we still recite that. We'll be doing it later today. Every Shabbat, the Kohanim were to bless the people. Some other things that people may not be familiar with: in Malachi chapter 3 and verse 10, the Kohanim were in charge of caring for the poor. They stored food in the temple for those in need. They stewarded the money that came in as offerings to the temple to repair the temple, to support the work of the ministry. In 1 Samuel chapter 4 and verse 4, the Kohanim led the army into battle, participated in warfare. So they, in our context, you might say, they were spiritual warriors. And in 2 Kings chapter 12 and verse 5, the Kohanim were responsible for the upkeep of the temple. Now that can be applied two ways, because where's the temple now? It's our bodies. So Kohanim are responsible to keep our bodies kept up, right? But also we have a place where we meet and gather, and other things that are for the kingdom of God, that advance the kingdom of God. The Kohanim are responsible for establishing, building those places, and keeping them up, maintaining them, repairing them, all of those kind of things. So, a lot of duties there, right? And we saw the requirements for becoming a Kohanim. So, let's look now, what are the privileges of being a Kohen? Well, obviously, the biggest one was, they were the ones who came into the Holy of Holies, the high priest did. So coming into God's presence, hearing from him, even seeing him. And we find that there's instructions for the Kohanim and their families to eat the offerings. That was part of their livelihood. So the Lord provided for the livelihood of the Kohanim from the offerings of the people. And they were to wear holy garments, but the scripture says to give them dignity and honor. So that's another privilege of the Kohanim. They are to be honored. The Kohanim, though, had no inheritance of the land. Their tribe had no inheritance. And the reason, anybody know what the reason was? Something else was their inheritance. The Lord himself was their inheritance. So that's another privilege of the Kohanim. And a big one that I saw there was the Kohanim were privileged with the assignment to bear fruit among the people by teaching them the word, by leading them in prayer, by leading them in worship, to bear fruit and see the people's spiritual lives develop and grow. So we've seen the requirements, we've seen the roles, we've seen the privileges of the Aaronic Kohanim. But you are supposed to be a Kohen of Yeshua, right? So what are his requirements for you to qualify to be his Kohen? And what roles are you to fulfill? And what privileges do you have as a royal Kohen? And also, what has Yeshua given us to enable us to be his Kohanim? We'll see an amazing correlation with the requirements of the Aaronic Kohanim, the roles and the privileges and the requirements of the Aaronic Kohanim, and the roles and the privileges and the requirements for Yeshua's Kohanim. So let's start with the requirements. Okay? What do you suppose is symbolized by the lifestyle requirements that the Aaronic Kohanim were given to be pure. We who are followers of Yeshua, we are to adhere to a higher standard of ethics than the world around us, right? And really, it's really high. Listen to what Yeshua said in Matthew 5. I tell you that unless your righteousness is far greater than that of the Torah teachers and the Purushim, that's the Pharisees, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. It's pretty serious, pretty serious. And of course, we understand that that righteousness is only attained through Yeshua's atoning sacrifice, right? And being led by the Spirit. But it also means that as we're led by the Spirit, we are going to be obedient to God and to His laws. It doesn't mean we can just do what we want. We have to be obedient. So that's one of the requirements. The functions. Your role as a Kohen are to worship God in spirit and in truth, to pray and intercede, to be led by the Spirit for direction and judging, and you are to teach God's words. You are to be a witness to people. Now, remember, one of the roles of the Kohanim was to make atonement. You can't make atonement, but you can lead people to the one who has made atonement. You can bless people with your prayers, just reciting a blessing over them, and you can bless them by helping them, by sharing with them, by defending them when they need defense. You are to care for the poor, the needy, the disabled, the sick, and the oppressed. Everybody recognizing these are the roles of the Mosaic or the Aaronic Kohanim. You are to steward the money and other resources God has given you for the kingdom of God. You are to engage in spiritual warfare. Speak out against sin and injustice. And you are to maintain the temple, your own body, but also this temple and other places where the kingdom of God is functioning. And what are your privileges as Kohanim of Yeshua? Come into God's presence. Hear from Him. God will provide all your needs and your family needs. God will honor you with crowns. You will bear fruit among people by teaching the word, by praying with them, by leading them in worship. And you will lead people, you are to lead people, to the great atonement maker, to Yeshua. So what did Yeshua give us to fulfill these requirements and to accomplish these roles? Well, in Jeremiah 31, a verse we're all familiar with, I will put my Torah, my words, within them, write it on their hearts. He puts His living word in His Kohanim, so we'll know it, and so we can teach others. And He writes it on our hearts so that we will want to obey it and be able to live that life of a higher level of purity than the world. In verse 34, Jeremiah 31, no longer will any of them teach his fellow community member or his brother, saying, know Adonai, for all will know me, from the least of them to the greatest, because I will forgive their wickednesses or their iniquities and remember their sins no more. So all Yeshua's Kohanim will know him personally. How will we know him? In John 14, but the Counselor, the Ruach HaKodesh, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything. That is, he will remind you of everything I have said to you. So God's Spirit will live in his Kohanim. And this word counselor is parakletos, meaning as a legal advisor. In other words, as someone who can show you how to obey God, but also to lead us and to instruct us. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. Moreover, God has the power to provide you with every gracious gift in abundance, so that always in every way you will have all you need and be able to provide abundantly for every good cause. So the Lord provides for his Kohanim to do the work of the Kohanim, to provide for every good cause. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 4. Then when the chief shepherd appears, the return of the Lord, you will receive glory as your unfading crown. You will be crowned honor and glory in the time of the Lord's return. John 15, verse 8, this is how my Father is glorified, and you are bearing much fruit. This is how you will prove to me my Talmudim, or my disciples. He promises that we, his Kohanim, will bear fruit. Meaning, really big meaning, our lives will have meaning. Our lives will have purpose. We will bear fruit for the kingdom of God. We will bring other peoples into the kingdom because we'll be bearing fruit. So we've seen the requirements. We've seen the roles and privileges. And we've seen how Yeshua is going to provide for us. But remember where we started. We started with God's instruction to Moses on what to do to Aaron and his sons to make them into Kohanim. So what has to happen to you to become a Kohen for Yeshua? So let's go back and look at what happens to the Aaronic Kohanim and see what the New Covenant parallels are. First, the Aaronic Kohanim had to be direct descendants of Aaron. Well, Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 20, if you can go on to the next slide there, says, Yeshua, who has become a Kohen Gadol forever, should be compared with Melchizedek or Melchizedek. Yeshua, our Kohen Hagadol, is of a different priestly order, the order of Melchizedek, different from the sons of Aaron. We are of that order. And in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 24, it says, but because he lives forever, his position as Kohen does not pass on to someone else. He's the only Kohen Hagadol there will ever be, and he serves forever. But the Kohanim who serve under this great Kohen Hagadol, we do pass on. So there is a passing on of the Mamlecha Kohanim, of the royal priesthood, from generation to generation, not by natural human descent. John chapter 1 verse 12 says this, but to as many as did receive him, to those who put their trust in his person and power, he gave the right to become children of God. Verse 13, not because of bloodline, physical impulse, or human intention, but because of God. So, what does this mean? Every Kohen of Yeshua must be born into the family of Yeshua, the family of Kohanim. So to be a Kohen of Yeshua, you must be born from above. You must be born again from above. Secondly, the Aaronic Kohanim had to be washed in water. And in Mark 16, Yeshua says this, whoever trusts and is immersed will be saved. Whoever does not trust will be condemned. So to be Yeshua's Kohen, what do you have to do? Be immersed in water. Third, the Aaronic Kohanim had to be dressed in priestly garments. Does not mean a prayer shawl. In Romans chapter 13, verse 14, Paul says this, clothe yourselves with the Lord Yeshua, the Messiah. We are to put on the priestly garment. The priestly garment is Yeshua himself. We are to put on him as a garment. And then we find that Moses laid his hands on the Aaronic Kohanim to ordain and consecrate them and set them apart. So what's the deal here? Who can do this today? Well, in 1 Timothy chapter 4, we read this in verse 14. Do not neglect the spiritual gift within you, which was given to you through prophecy with the laying on of hands of the elders. Now, we need to be cautious about this because the Bible warns we are to be careful, cautious, who we lay hands on to ordain. When we ordain people as pastors or evangelists or prophets, we are told to be cautious as to how we do that. But Scripture also says that we are all Kohanim. We are all priests. And if the way to become a Kohen is to be ordained as a Kohen, we need to have hands laid on us to be ordained as a Kohen. Buddy, follow that? And then the Aaronic Kohanim had to be sanctified, set apart for God. So let's look into this a little bit, because this is interesting. Exodus chapter 29, verse 1. Now this is what you are to do to consecrate them, so that they may minister to me as Kohanim. So the word here, where it says consecrate, is actually that same word, kadesh, which is sanctify them or set them apart. So the Kohanim were to be washed and clothed, and a bull and two rams were to be sacrificed, and matzahs were to be brought, unleavened bread was to be brought. And then in verse 22 of Exodus 29, this ram, a second ram, was to be brought, and the second ram was called the ram of ordination. And the matzahs were called the matzahs of ordination. So the instruction was, first sacrifice the bull and one ram, and then the second ram of ordination was to be sanctified. Now, and many of you have understood this, we've talked about this many times, Yeshua's sacrifice fulfilled all the sacrifices in the Mosaic Law. So I believe Yeshua's sacrifice fulfilled the ordination of his Kohanim. Otherwise, how could we be his Kohanim? But look at how it's supposed to be done. Verse 20 of Exodus 29, slaughter the ram. This is the ram of ordination. Take its blood, and dab it on the tip of the right ear of Aaron, on the tip of the right ears of his sons, on the thumb of their right hands, and on the big toes of their right feet. Then pour the blood on the altar all around. So this was the blood of ordination offering placed on the ear, the thumb, and the toe. Now, first thing to understand, why these places on the human body? Well, it's pretty clear the symbolism. The ear to do what? To hear from God. The thumb to do what? To do what God tells us to do. And the toe to do what? To go where he tells us to go. Okay? Now understand, this was not an anointing with oil, but it was a sanctification with blood. Okay? They're not the same thing. So when I got to this point in my study this week, my reaction was, well, how do we do this? Do I go buy a ram and sacrifice it and put the blood on people's ears? I didn't think that was going to happen. And then I had this revelation that I'd had before, but the Lord showed me the application to this. Yeshua fulfilled the sacrifice of the ram of ordination. So his blood is the blood of the priestly ordination. So when we come to the Lord's table, what we call the Sudat Adonai, or communion, the juice represents what? His blood. And it normally represents the blood of his atonement, or the blood of the new covenant. But what I saw is that it also represents the blood of our ordination as Kohanim. So when we drink it, now here's the biological part, or the physiological part. When we drink something, where does it eventually go? Every cell in your body. So it gets eventually to your ear and your thumb and your big toe. And then there's the second part. Verse 32 of, again, chapter 29 of Exodus. Aaron and his sons are to eat the meat of the ram and the bread that is in the basket at the entrance of the tent of meeting. This is the bread of the ordination, or the matzah of the ordination. So they had to eat this. That was part of their ordination. So, again, I went through the same process of, well, how do we do this? Well, Yeshua fulfilled the offering of the ram and the matzah, so his body is the food of the priestly ordination. And so when we come to the Lord's table, the matzah represents what? His body, broken for our healing. But again, we can also see it as the food of his ordination. One more thing about the Kohanim before we're going to actually do this. God has given us a name that signifies we are Kohanim. It's a bit of a secret that we have this name, mostly because the translations make it hard to see the name. So here's what this name is. In English, Yeshua has two titles, right? What are the two titles? Messiah and Christ. Those are the two titles, right? Now, Messiah comes from a transliteration of the Hebrew Mashiach, anointed one. Okay? That's the root that I ask you to try to pronounce. Remember, Mashiach means to anoint. So Mashiach is the anointed one. Christ comes from a transliteration of the Greek Christos. Christos is Greek for anointed one. Okay? So a Christian really literally means a follower of the Christ, a follower of the anointed one, the Christos. Everybody follow that so far? Okay, so how does this relate to us? In the 1970s, Jewish followers of Yeshua were called Hebrew Christians. And our organization, our national organization, was called the Hebrew Christian Alliance of America. But many young Jewish believers had a problem with this name because of the history of Christian persecution of Jews over the centuries. So they didn't want to identify as a type of Christian, like a Chinese Christian or a Portuguese Christian. Everybody follow that? Even though the real meaning of the word is a follower of the Christos, the anointed one. So Martin Chernoff, Joel Chernoff's father, David Chernoff's father, he was a pioneer of the Messianic movement. He had a vision. And in the vision, he saw the words Messianic Judaism written on a banner in the sky. Messianic, because we're believers in the Messiah, the anointed one. And Judaism, because we're still Jewish, so that we can identify ourselves as being still Jewish and combat that lie that once you become a believer in the Messiah, what happens? You're not Jewish anymore. That's the lie Jewish people have been taught. So after much contention about this name change, you can read about the contention in Paul Lieberman's book, Don't Call Me Christian. The Hebrew Christian Alliance of America was changed to the Messianic Jewish Alliance of America. So Jewish followers of Yeshua began to be called what? Messianic Jews. Right. Well, here's where this becomes very interesting. If you translate Messianic Jew back into Hebrew, it's Yehudi Mishihi. Yehudi Mishihi. I got the accent wrong. Yehudi Mishihi. Yehudi is how you say Jew in Hebrew. Yehudi. It comes from Yehuda, the tribe of Judah. Everybody follow that? Okay, Mishihi is that same root word, Meshach. It has the KH sound. It means messianic, meaning a follower of the Messiah. And the plural would be Yehudim, instead of Yehudi, Yehudim Mishihim. That's how you make the plurals in Hebrew, yeah, the I am. But what's important to you here today is that in Hebrew, Yehudi Mishihi has two meanings. Number one, it's a Jewish follower of the anointed one, okay? But the second meaning is very interesting. It means an anointed Jew or anointed Jewish person. So if you're a Messianic Jew, it means you're an anointed Jew. See how interesting that is? Okay. Who were the anointed ones in the Tanakh? The priests. So our name, Messianic Jews, actually speaks of that anointed priestly role. A Messianic Jew is an anointed Jew and thus a Kohen. Now what about non-Jewish people in the Messianic movement? Certainly the word Mishichim still applies, followers of the Messiah, right? Now the first idea of the other word comes to mind is Gentile, Messianic Gentile. And in the Hebrew, that would be Goyim, of the nations. So it would be Goyim Meshichim. But in modern Hebrew, Goy or Goyim has got a negative connotation. It's kind of a put down. Okay? And in English, Gentiles can have a negative connotation too, because some Bibles speak of Gentiles as like the heathen. All right. So there's a better word. The word is Ger. Simple word. Ger. G-E-R. It's a non-Jewish person who has thrown in their lot, become a part of the Jewish people, lives among the Jewish people. And we have a great example of this. Who knows who the example is? Ruth. Ruth was born a Goy. She was from the nation of Moab, right? But she, by a decision, by deciding to stay with Naomi, she became a Ger. So the name Ger Mishihi, or Gerim Mishichim for plural, is the one that I've been teaching people and that we like to use. But again, what's important about that is when you take that back into the Hebrew, it also has two meanings, which you guys can guess at already. It's a non-Jewish person who has become part of the Jewish people, who is a follower of the Anointed One, right? But the second meaning is the same. It's an anointed ger. It's an anointed ger. So it's a Kohen. It's an anointed ger. A ger mishihi is a non-Jewish person who is anointed, and thus a Kohen. Everybody got that? So everybody here who is a follower of Yeshua are either Yehudi Mishihi or Ger Mishihi. Either way, your very name says you are anointed, meaning your very name is that you are a priest, a Kohen. Okay. All right. So we're going to come to the Lord's table. Okay. And all of you who have entered into the new covenant are welcome to participate. Let me just say, if there's anyone here who hasn't put your trust in Yeshua and you want to, today, you want to say, I want to follow Yeshua, you are free to participate, and this is your first act, your first stepping into the kingdom of God. For those who already trust in Yeshua, the Holy Spirit is inviting you today to partake of this juice and matzah as a sanctification to be a Kohen. And remember, the Aaronic Kohanim were also anointed with oil, and hands were laid on them. So what I've asked our elders to do today is, after we take the juice and the matzah, the elders will be available to anoint with oil and lay hands on all who are led to take the step of saying, I want to follow all of the steps to be a Kohen. I want to be a Kohen. Remember, this is serious. There were all those requirements. All those roles to fulfill and that purity to maintain. But there were also those privileges that were in there. So let's distribute the elements. And I'm going to put up here this slide, which, as we're distributing elements, you can just kind of meditate on to make sure you really want to take this step, because it is a serious thing. The requirements of purity, the calling, all of us are called, I believe. The roles, a long list of roles, and of course, the privileges.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel, while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events, where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670, or you can write us at 1326 North Whitten Road, Rochester, New York, 14609. Or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service, Saturday mornings at 10 a.m. Complete children's program, interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. We hope you'll visit the Free Tree Messianic Jewish Bookstore located in the lobby of Shema Yisrael. Call for hours. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bagels and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick, Sundays from 2 to 3 p.m. on WRCI 102.7 FM. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Reg A. Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.